We are asking our members to please prepare yourselves to assist in this great event. We will have a brief meeting after service today to give details. Thank you so much for your cooperation. Next, our virtual Bible study will be held this Tuesday at 6 p.m. Please be prepared, 6:30 p.m. Please be prepared to tune in on Facebook. Next week is our Easter Sunday, and we'll wear our traditional white t-shirts and denim. And also, please remember to pick up the monthly calendar so you can be informed on all church events and information, such as this Friday is Good Friday, so we'll be fasting and praying from 8 a.m. to 12 p.m. So now we will have our health awareness. Oh, we'll have our Sunday school first by Sister Jennifer Thomas, and then followed by our health awareness by Cece. Giving reverence to God, my wonderful pastor, beautiful first lady, Pastor Libby Thomas.
Amen.
To our Living Word family and friends, both here present and in Facebook land. I was given the task for Sunday school today.
Amen.
And I'm going to say, after reading this lesson over and over again, I was trying to see how to condense this lesson, but there's no way to do so. So I'm going to ask that you bear with me while I give you some very, very important information today for your daily task. Our Sunday school lesson today is Thoughts on the Lord's Supper. Our lesson text is 1 Corinthians 11, chapter 20 through 31st. 34 verses, sorry. Our golden text, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. 1 Corinthians 11:26. The Corinthian church was a troubled church, perhaps the most troubled of all churches to which Paul wrote. In many ways, including their observance of communion, their spiritual life revealed division and heresies. So Paul's teaching in this week's lesson was meant to correct their conduct regarding the practice of communion, and probably ours today. Not only was he reminding the church of the proper way to do it, but that communion was also a reminder that Jesus' death initiated the fulfillment of the new covenant promise. Pride for division had so taken over in the Corinthian church that it even disrupted the Lord's Supper. Instead of honoring Jesus Christ during the communion, the people turned it into a time of self-gratification. Whatever the congregation's intentions may have been concerning communion, their behavior made it impossible to call this meal the Lord's in any sense. The early churches followed the Lord's example when he ate with his disciples when they observed their communion. The Corinthian believers would gather for a common meal called the Love Feast, where members would bring food and share with one another. However, the wealthier members normally bought more than they needed, but wouldn't share with those who could not afford much. Wow. So at the same table, one could find those who were hungry for lack of food and others gorging themselves with food they did not need. Mm. The Corinthians had made a farce of this Love Feast, selfishness reigning. Not only were some people sitting at the table going hungry while others had more than they needed, some had drank so much wine that they were drunken or drunk. Just as the Lord followed his Passover meal by instituting his communion service, the Corinthians waited until their dinner was over to partake of the Lord's Supper. But there was no real fellowship or communion taking place. Throughout the entire Love Feast, they didn't show any love for one another, nor did they show any reverence for Jesus Christ and his supper. As a result of their selfish behavior, Paul was telling them they could go and overeat and get drunk in their own homes. Paul was telling these believers they were showing contempt for the church of God and humiliating the poor believers who had nothing to eat. Paul now proceeded to explain how the Lord's table should be observed. And this is also where we should take note. himself about revelation from Christ and what he had received, he communicated it precisely to the Corinthians without varying from the truth, without adding to it or taking away from it. The Lord's Supper was instituted by Jesus the same night in which he was betrayed. Judas, who betrayed Jesus, had left the upper room before Jesus instituted the observance of the Lord's Supper. This was important because Jesus intended only for those who were truly saved to take part in the Lord's Supper. So when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, Judas was not saved. At some point during the last Passover meal, Paul said Jesus took bread. He was now beginning to institute the Lord's Supper. Remember, Paul is reviewing to the Corinthians what Jesus said and did when he instituted the Lord's Supper. The bread Jesus used was the ordinary unleavened bread used at Passover, similar to what the Corinthians were using. However, the Lord gave it a new symbolic significance. First, Jesus gave thanks for the bread. The giving thanks was a grateful acknowledgement of God's mercy and request for his blessing. Then Jesus broke it, meaning that he broke it, the bread, in order to share it with all his disciples while he was speaking to them. Then his disciples were told to take, eat. This distribution and eating of the bread by the disciples around the table that night made it a communion of fellowship service. They shared the bread together. Jesus then explained to his disciples, "This is my body." The bread was a symbol of his body, not his physical body. He was using a figure of speech, as he often did when he referred to himself. Paul further explained that Jesus told his disciples that his body would be broken for you. His body was given over to a violent death for all his people. This was because Jesus' death was a sacrificial and substitutionary offering for sin, all our sins. The purpose of the Lord's Supper is to remember Jesus and his death for sin. Therefore, the focus of the observant must be on Jesus Christ. It is a memorial service of his death. The Corinthians believers, by their conduct, had devoured the whole intent of the Lord's Supper. It should be noted that the command, "This do in remembrance of me," is in the present tense and signifies an action that is to be done repeatedly over and over. In other words, he was saying, keep on doing this. Jesus was not only commanding his disciples to partake that night, but also to continue to repeat the same act. Jesus did the same with the cup, giving thanks as he had done with the bread. He took the cup from the table, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples. Their drinking from the cup was also an act of communion or fellowship, for they shared the cup together. The phrase, "when he had supped," indicates that Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper after they finished eating the Passover meal. The cup symbolized Christ's blood that was shed in his death. It was the blood of the New Testament. The Greek term for testament means covenant. Jesus then told his disciples, "This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me." In other words, as often as they drink the cup, they were to do so in remembrance of him. The ordinance of the Lord's Supper is to be observed regularly by God's people. How often we are to partake of the Lord's Supper is not stated specifically. Only the general statement was given, "as often as you drink it," meaning that whenever or how often we decide to eat and drink of the Lord's table, it should be done, as Jesus said, in remembrance of me. Both the cup and the bread were reminders of Jesus' death and his purpose in God's plan of salvation. Each time we gather at the Lord's table, we are reminded that we are sinners forgiven through the blood of Jesus Christ, symbolized by the fruit of the vine. Whenever the Lord's Supper is in act, it should be observed in line with Scripture. It must be kept in remembrance of Christ and his death. He is to be the focal point of the ordinance. Paul declared that whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. The word unworthily does not mean unworthy. No one is worthy of Christ's salvation or the Lord's Supper. It is only by God's grace that we eat and drink at the Lord's table. The issue is not worthiness to participate, but the manner in which it is observed. Unworthily means to approach communion without preparing the heart and mind to recognize its true meaning. Simply put, to eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily means partaking in the Lord's Supper without unconfessed sins and not focusing on his death for our sins. If we are from living in sin and our focus is on anything except Jesus' substitutionary death, we are eating and drinking unworthily, participating in the Lord's Supper without realizing the significance of the ordinance is a serious offense. It's when we participate in an unworthy manner that we become guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. In other words, when we partake of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, instead of proclaiming the Lord's death by realizing the significance of the symbols of the Lord's Supper, we share the guilt of those who put Jesus to death. Mm-hmm. Having stated that self-examination was necessary, now the apostles declares that any believer who participates at the Lord's table in an unworthy manner would incur God's displeasure. He said, for he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself. The Greek word for damnation means judgment. In this text, it refers to the chastening of believers by the Lord. This is not internal damnation or judgment. It is God's correction of a Christian. If Paul was referring to eternal damnation as being the results of anyone who has taken communion in an unworthy manner, very few believers will have any hope of going to heaven. Therefore, the damnation or judgment by God the damnation or judgment Paul had in mind was some disciplinary action taken directly by God on their worshiper. It's true that we can expect God to discipline us when we are disobedient. However, Paul said that we can avoid such discipline if we engage in self-examination that assures that we are living acceptable lives before the world and God. When Christians examine themselves, they seek divine help to overcome their sinful tendencies instead of waiting for divine judgment or discipline to fall. The communion service in our church is a time for remembering the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, but we also need to keep in mind the larger context of the service. We are really remembering the new covenant that Jesus instituted at the Last Supper. At the heart of that covenant is his death, leading to our salvation. Let us come to our next communion service with a humble spirit, examining our lives and judging our own sin. Let us also think consciously about the new covenant which provides our salvation through Jesus Christ. And that is our Sunday school lesson.
Amen.
Psychologists define self-control as the ability to control behaviors in order to avoid temptations and to achieve goals. The second definition is the ability to delay gratification and resist unwanted behaviors. While self-discipline is the ability to make yourself do things that should be done. So, for example, using myself for example, self-control is I eat one scoop of ice cream instead of two. And self-discipline is eating more vegetables because that's something you're supposed to do. So how does this relate to our health? Well, when we practice self-control and self-discipline, we are more likely to make wise choices and achieve more long-term goals. Also, studies have shown that people who practice self-discipline and self-control are one less anxious. That's because when they experience negative emotions, they tend to distract themselves by focusing on something else. And the thing they pretty much focus on is the things that are more important to them. Second thing is that they're less likely to suffer from an addiction. That's because with self-control and self-discipline, you're most likely to make wise choices.
That's true.
And lastly, in a 2011 study, people who practice self-discipline and self-control are more likely to have reduced risk of cardiovascular disease. So in this study, they looked at the correlation between self-control and health in men, and they found that 56% of men who practice self-control, self-discipline, have reduced risk of cardiovascular disease. And that's because they are less likely to engage in risky behaviors and behaviors that are health damaging, such as smoking, drinking, and other things. So as we go after the day, just try to, practice. practice self-control. That's the fruit of the spirit. So as Christians, we should always practice self-control and self-discipline. It's good for your health. That's the way to put it.
Come on, make some noise all over the building. I don't know what you come to do, but I came to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for being a father. Thank you for being a sister. open my mouth and say praise. We come now, God, against every spirit, God,
that will lurk against your people to come to destroy their minds, to confuse their hearts. Touch now, Father, Spirit of the living God. We know that your word is sharper than a two-edged sword. It will cut us going in, it will cut us coming back out of us. Allow your words, God, to heal, deliver, and set free. Thank God for this Sunday, God. As we commemorate the Palm Sunday, as you triumphantly entered it, and God, the people cried out, Hosanna. We come crying this morning, oh, Hosanna to the highest. You're worthy of our honor, glory, and praise. So now, Lord, touch. Guide us, strengthen us. In the mighty name of Jesus, give us what we need today. In Jesus' name, amen. And thank God. Amen. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise in this place. Amen. Oh, well, we will sing. Well, spending time. Praise God.
Don't you do it, Reverend? Don't you?
Yeah. Know. Praise God. Matthew's the 21st chapter. Amen. My thoughts are scattered. Matthew's 21st chapter. Let us stand for the reverence of the reading of God's word. Matthew's 21st chapter, starting at verse 12. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all of them that sold and brought in the temple and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves, and said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. And the blind and the lame came in the temple, and he healed them. And the blind and the lame came in the temple, and he healed them. And when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, then the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. They were sore displeased and said unto him, hearest thou these say? And Jesus said unto them, ye have never read out of the mouths of babes and sucklings thou had perfected praise. And he left them and went out in the city of Bethany. And he lodged there. Now in the morning, as he returned to the city, he hungered. And when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon. Believed only and said unto it, let no fruits grow on thee henceforth forever. And presently the fig tree withered away. You may have your seats in the presence of the Almighty God. I want to talk to you this morning, and I want to lift from the scriptures 12 through 18 that it's time for our spring cleaning.
Right.
It's time for our spring cleaning. Amen. It's time for spring cleaning. Amen.
Amen.
Traditionally, as we celebrate in the house of worship, we celebrate Palm Sunday. This is the time when they say that Jesus entered the city and they had palm leaves and they was crying out, Hosanna. And they was giving God the praises and they was magnifying him for all of his goodness and his mercy. All the things that God had did for the people. You know, he was healing the sick, and he was raising the dead, and he was giving sight to the blind. And people were crying out. They was receiving at this time. And they was happy. Sort of like us, you know what I'm saying? We're happy when things are good for us. When our emotions are being satisfied, we are happy. But there come a time in your life that you get cluttered and that you sometimes lose your sight. You don't lose your way because you know that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and that nobody can come to God except through Christ. You can say Buddha, you can say Confucius, you can say Muhammad, you could say trees, or birds, whatever, sun, yoga, whatever you want to say. But the bottom line is you got to come through God. In order to come to God, you must go through his son. Going through his son requires us to accept his son, Jesus Christ, who's going to die for us. And in our lives today, we are dying. Amen. We are a dead breed of believers. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't love God like you ought to love God. You don't worship him like you should worship. You don't praise him like you should praise him. You don't give him the reverent respect like you should give him, like you give everything else in your life. You don't give it to God like you should. Matter of fact, you love your wife greater than you love God. You love your children more than you love God. You love your substance or your poison more than you love God, because you give more attention, time, and efforts to the things that feed your ego. God said to us this morning, it's time for spring cleaning. It's time. When Jesus entered into this place, this is the time. In verse 12a, he said, and when Jesus went into the temple, in other words, you know, 1 Corinthians tells us that our bodies are the temple of God. 1 Thessalonians, I'm sorry, tells us that our bodies are the temple of God, right? And that God dwells on the inside. Therefore, we can't keep on putting anything in our temple. Because if Jesus is going to enter in, at least at this season of life. Now, next Sunday, we're going to celebrate the fact that we as believers was a part of the Sanhedrin Council that crucified him. We were the same part of the mob that cried Hosanna. We was complacent in our behavior, allowing him. So when he comes into the temple, he finds in the temple people selling pigeons for sacrifices, lambs, doves trying to make God's house a means of exchange. Actually, in God's house, a lot of our religious groups have formulated their belief system, which we know is far from the church. But at the same time, they have formulated it on the religious principles, because Christ is the solid rock, all of us think, and everything else is sinking. So when we look at God, they came into the temple to sell. And a lot of us sitting here this morning are selling God. We're selling him for the highest price. We sell God when it's only convenient for us to sell him. We need to do some spring cleaning. We need to clean up our minds. We need to clean up our hearts. We need to clean up our thoughts. Because only thing that you are selling is yourself out. Because God says, I am the same yesterday. I'm the same today. And then tomorrow, when you get it together, I'm going to be the same God. So when we look at spring cleaning, we look at, you know, we go in our houses and we dust off some stuff. We dust off the things that we never touched in a year's time. You're surprised when you go clean your air conditioned vents to how dusty they are. Can you imagine how dusty your spirit is? Your spirit just is dusty. You can't breathe. A filter to an air conditioning system is the nostrils. It's the lungs that makes it breathe so easy. But without the filter being clean, it places strain on the nostrils, pulling in the air in order to filter your lungs. Huh? It's hard. And same way your spirit, God is saying that you have come into this house. We don't clean it. We don't give our energy and our time. We don't give our resources, because it's so important that our houses, the ones that are corrupt, is built. Jesus said, as he entered into the temple, he found them in verse 12:8. He found them, and they was casting out lots, saying, you know, I bet you this, I bet you that. I give you this, I give you that. Can't you see yourself compromising with God's word? Compromising with the fact that whatever you have, you are selling it to people. God says, we have a need. We have a need of his presence. We should be willing to let him perform a spring cleaning in our lives. We should allow God to come in our hearts and sweep up the room that we haven't swept in a long time. Maybe that room is forgiveness. Maybe that room is rededication. Maybe that room is that, Lord, no longer my will, but now it's your will. Can we perform a spring cleaning? Can we ask God to come in our hearts, erase our ideology, because our ideologies are wrong. They are fickle. They change with the atmosphere. Am I right about it? Don't lie to me, because CDC says the virus is contained. Go back to your normal routine. We're going back to normal routine. CDC says there's a rising of number of cases now. And everybody say, oh, it's back. So we change based on what the media says, right? But we don't change based on what God says. God says no weapon, y'all. God says by his stripes we are healed. God says that you can do all things through him that's strengthening you. And the first thing you say is what I can't do. Because somebody shared no with you. God says, I want to do some spring cleaning. In this Palm Sunday, allow God's presence to be your cleaning. Allow his presence as your acceptance on his presence. He is in you. He is with you. And he wants to talk to you. He's knocking at the altar of all of our hearts, saying, can I come in? Can I come in and sup with you and you sup with me? The Sunday school lesson dealt with the communion. It is the time that Jesus says, hey, go tell my disciples to meet me in Galilee. And there they're going to have the Last Supper before he is hung, bled, and he's going to die. To become the propitiation of our sin. He says his presence is needed. Then the second thing is his preeminence. His majesty. Watch in 12b. He said, and overthrew the money changers and the seed of them that sold doves. He cast out all of them. He entered in 12a. But 12b, he took control. Y'all see? Y'all see 12a? Jesus says, the word says, and Jesus went into the temple. Now that's a denote some authority. He says, he goes in the temple. All right? And the people that are doing wrong, he is witnessing it. Just like some of us witness, right? But 12b, his preeminency says that I'm got to take control because this ain't right. My question to you is when you enter into God's house and you see things that are not right, do you and I take control and say, this ain't right? Or do we sit back and say, it ain't my business? God's saying, if you do some spring cleaning in your house, you and I both will say, hey, it ain't right. It ain't right for the church to be nasty. It ain't right for the chairs to be out of line. It ain't right for us to not have enough to do whatever we need to do. It ain't right, y'all. It ain't right. So he took his presence, made a difference. My question to you this morning, do your presence makes a difference in the places that you show up in? Or do you contribute to the problem? And the question that I love to ask us is, what are we going to do about it? How do we change? Well, we change by spring cleaning. We change by saying, you know, so long have I roamed, God. So long have I did this not my way. You got to think about it. All the days of your life, you ain't changed since you was grown. There's ought to be a time now you ought to change. You ought to just say, okay, God, you're right. I'm going to give it over to you. That's what I did. That's what I do. That's what I strive. Listen, I know it's easier for Timothy to go back to the streets, but I got to say that in my spring cleaning, I got to keep on cleaning. I got to keep on allowing when he comes in, he taking control. Because if I stay in control, I'm going to mess it up. I'm challenging y'all because I recognize that the things I should do, I find myself doing. And the things I ought to do, I find myself giving excuses why I should not do. So, we ought to be able to say today, okay, I surrender. I'm going to surrender harder than I ever surrendered before. I'm going to surrender my all and give it over to you, God. My time, my talent, my gifts, I'm going to surrender it because Only what I do for Christ is going to last. Relationships don't last. Huh? People in love don't last. Huh? I'm with you 1 minute and I'm not with you the next. I like you today, I hate you tomorrow. Right? I'm a marry you this month, I'm a divorce you next month. Huh? Except that marriage is gonna happen in 2 months from now. We got a marriage, they're gonna be, you know, we got some lovebirds in the back gonna get married in June. And look at him, we're gonna party and we're gonna have a good time. You know, we gotta act like it's our way. You know what I'm saying? You know, I mean, hey, you know, I mean, we ready. It's a new life. And God's saying, I want a new life with you. I want you to spring clean yourself. It's a good time for you to rededicate yourself. He says, his preeminency made a change. Look at verse 13. I'm about to close. Look at verse 13. He says, his proclamation. And this is what you and I need to do. He said, and he said unto them, Israel, my house shall be called what? The house of what, y'all? In other words, we all come here and pray. Not play. We all come here and pray. Tuesdays, we all pray. We ought to communicate with God. See, you and I need him where we at. He doesn't need us. The only time that Jesus said, I have need of them, is Matthew 11 and 3. He says, I have need of you. But the need of you was not that I need you to do what? To do what I need you to do, because I am who I say I am. Huh? I'm water when you're thirsty. I'm food when you're hungry. He said, I don't need you to be a healer, because I am the healer. I don't need you to provide, because I am Jehovah Jireh, your provider. Huh? So, no matter what you need, I am that. I don't need you that. You need me. See, the truth of the matter, if we clean up ourselves, we'll understand how much we really need him. Therefore, we'll say to God during this time, he says that you have made my house a den of thieves. We ought to say, forgive us, God. Forgive us. As we clean up, his proclamation gives us an example of how to get out of what we got in. Give us a way out. Isn't it good to have an escape route? No matter how much you get into a fix, God always give you a way out. Huh? All right, let me say it this way. No matter how much you put yourself in a lie, no matter how many lies you tell, and at the end of the line, God said, okay, I'm going to give you a safe line. I'm going to give you a way out of this. And here comes your way out. Blame it on me. Out of all the lies you told, and you were able to say, he made me. Doesn't it feel good when the light is off you? It does. When you can say, I mean, I ain't drink that. I ain't eat that. Man, look at her. I ain't look at her. You know you looking. Huh? Except Wallace. Yeah, he can't see. He can't see at the time, you know what I'm saying? If my eyes see something, I ain't gonna lie and tell you no, I ain't saw that. I saw all of it. If I'm on the beach and she naked, I'm looking. I'm not gonna lie. Because if he on the beach, nigga, you looking. And then gotta say, I ain't see that. Where are you blind? And in the scripture, Jesus says this. He said, the lame and the blind was healed. See, God gonna heal us, y'all. All right. But he can't heal us lying. Huh? What we gotta do is just clean it up. If I see you naked, then I gotta cover you. I gotta protect you as my sister or my brother. Sister, don't do that. Brother, don't do that. And that's what God is asking all of the aged women in this church to do, is to help these young folks. I rode my motorcycle and I was so sickened. I visited Grambling on a spring football game. And I seen more pornography at a football game than you watch on TV. I seen more gay folks holding hands. I seen girls with breasts out, with bandana scars tied around their chicks, with the cleavage covered, and the underneath the breast exposed. Just nasty. But you want men to respect you. These are kids we sent off to college. That when they get around each other, they forget where they come from. They forget where they was trained. It's time for us to really clean ourselves. That's what God is saying this morning. Can you make a proclamation statement that for God you live and for God you're going to die? No matter where you go, you're going to act the same. God is asking all of us in this day and time to clean our lives up, to be who we say we are. That's a child of the Most High God. You and I are like, we're going to fall and get right back up. But we can respect ourselves in the process. We can make sure that at least we do what God wants us to do. So as we look at Matthew 21:12-16, spring cleaning. Again, this is the time of year when many housewives scrub away dirt of winter with the spring cleaning their home. And Jesus performed the spring cleaning of his own with the cleaning of the temple. We should be willing also to let him perform the spring cleaning in our lives with his presence, his preeminence, the proclamation that he made. And then in verse 14, he says, and the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. It was a den of thieves, and then it was a hospital. God is saying, once you clean up your life, no matter where you at, he can change your place to the place that he gets the power of God. Because you know the Bible says that he have given us power to tread upon the serpents. So that means if anything happens to you, that you have the power to tread upon it. But see, you don't recognize your power in a whole bunch of clutter, do you? Huh? You don't know how to find the stuff that's hidden that you have purchased a long time ago. It's funny because I looked in the vehicle on last night, and I was taking out all the things that I purchased for houses that we're dealing with. And I found something that I've been looking for. Well, guess what? I would have never found it had not I cleaned up. You buy things over and over and over and over again that you already purchased, which means then you waste because you can't find that tool. You can't find that item that fits where you need to go. You can't finish your job because you misplaced this and you forgot what you got. It costs too much to go buy it again. So you have to wait. God is saying, if you clean up, you can organize yourself. That's what I want to part this morning with. That even his presence, if his presence doesn't make a difference in your life, then you need to check your relationship. Whenever you take time to read God's word, you ought to be able to have a goosebump experience. Just like when that girl for the first time walks in your life, that woman walks in your life. And guys, and she make you feel strange. Or women, when that guy walks in your life and he makes you feel good on the inside, you ought to say to Christ how you appreciate him. How you honor and you worship him. His presence makes a difference. His presence makes a difference because of his preeminence. He's God Almighty. When you read the word of God and you see, and God said, you be like, hold up, y'all, be quiet. God is speaking. See, the power of words in the book, they taught us to read in elementary. And in the midst of that, it showed you that words are powerful. God is saying this morning how powerful is his words. He's going to proclaim to us that no matter what you go through in life, no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. Throughout time, God has constantly told us that. As we enter into Palm Sunday and we throw out the leaves of God, don't throw out the leaves this morning and say, okay, God, you're welcome. Hosanna, thank you, God. And then this week you cry, crucify him. When you need someone to blame, you know. When you need a scapegoat to cover that lie. Don't cry, crucify him this week. That escape route for that lie. You are shouting, crucify. When you did what you should not have done, you're crying, crucify. When you failed to pay your tithes, you're crying, crucify. When you failed to take up the communion, you're saying, crucify. When you failed to serve mankind, you're saying, crucify. When you failed to take care of your house, you're crying, crucified. Don't yell for an excuse this week. Crucify. Understand his power. He come to heal and deliver. John 10 said, the thief coming not but to kill, steal, and to destroy. Jesus said, I come that you may have what? Life. And that you may have it more abundant. Lastly, I want to say to you, in verse 15 and verse 16, it gives a problem for people. Verse 15 says, and when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and then they saw the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. The leaders, the scribes, the Pharisees, the Bible said they were so what? Displeased. Can I ask you a question? Why is the leadership so against the move of God when the leadership should be for the move of God? Why is it that the people in the church don't want to do what God says, but they want to do what the choir says? They want to do what the usher boys say. They want to do what the do-nothers do. But they don't want to do what God says. God says, give and it shall be given. Good measures, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall be given. Shall me and give us a yoke. For with the same measure you meet, it's going to be measured to you again. The key is, let me share this with you. The church is not in need of nothing. You are in need of. God is perfect. Everything God needs, he got. Didn't he show you that when we had the $18,000 goal? Those who gave, gave. Those who didn't, didn't. But he still met the need, didn't he? Mr. Eve Way from Alabama. Someone heard it on tape. Send $1,000 towards that goal. God has need of nothing. You have need of everything. And then you sit and want God to do stuff in your life. God is saying, I'm ready to do it. Whatever you need him to do, he's ready. But you got to clean up. You got to clean up. You got to give. You got to give yourself mind, talent, and gifts to God. Take the education that you have and apply it towards God. Take the skills you have. Apply it towards God's kingdom. Because what God says, the devil in hell cannot kick against him. In your life, in my life. Palm Sunday is coming and is here. Allow this time for us to clean up ourselves. Get back on track. So Sunday when we celebrate, he rose. Because all of us gonna allow on him this week. I'm too hungry to lay. But all of us gonna lie on it and say, God said, you know, God said to you, for you to do this, do that. Man, God didn't leave me to do this. What are you lying? Man, God said, no, you're lying. You see. So when we crucify him, we're gonna try to raise him Sunday morning. And man, we're gonna be here dressed in white and denim. And we're going to like, hero, yes, hero, hero, yes, hero. But we ain't going to be having no eggs around here because ain't no children coming from no eggs. Hello, somebody. You know, rabbit don't lay eggs. I mean, you know, you need to understand that. Now, you know, I was a little slow, but I ain't that slow. We know that God is able, amen? And so I want all of us to go to our vehicles, clean up our vehicles this week. And when you clean your vehicle up, you know, take your mats out and wash your mats. And watch how good your vehicle feels. You're going to get a little bit more gas mileage. Huh? I started it last night. Why? Because I want God to say on Sunday morning when I enter into the sanctuary, I want to say to him, Lord, not only did I clean up, you know, my life, but I cleaned up the vehicle that brought me to your house. I cleaned up my house that I live in. I cleaned up everything that I have. Because what I want to do is present myself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto you. So I share with you this morning. Clean up your life, that God may get the glory. And then when we come Sunday, we can sing, I'ma lay down my burdens. Down by, I'm gonna lay down, down by, and study. That's what we want to do. So my time is up. I thank you for yours. Amen. God is saying this morning, clean up. There may be someone here that want to clean up their life by giving their life back to God. There may be someone here that's in a backsliding condition, and you want to come back to God. We ask that you will come. As we sing one stanza of "We Are For Christ and You, My Brother, My Sister," we ask that you will come. There may be someone here that says that I want to unite with your fellowship. Come. There may be someone here that's in clutter, and they say, "Lord, I just need your prayer. I need you to be with me." Come. There may be someone that said, "I just want a closer walk with thee." Come. There may be someone. Whatever it is, come. As we stand and we sing, we offer Christ. Let us sing. commitment, we thank you. For restoration, we thank you. That no weapon formed is going to prosper, God. We thank you now, God. How the enemy comes in as a flood, God, and all seek it, God. And Father, you raise up a standard. You shield us and you protect us. So do it now, God, in the lives of your people here. Oh, Father, I know what's going on. I know how the enemy comes in. I know how he is trying to attack each individual, Father. But God, you show up. Show yourself mighty. In the mighty name of your Son. Thank God for being God. Thank you. We declare and decree, God, no weapon formed. Weapons of our minds, talents, or ideals will be able to separate us. But besides being gifted, he's anointed for a time such as this. Let us present ourselves back to you. Let this Sunday be a representation that we are cleaned up. Church. constant. We come, God, against that spirit that will keep us from being on Facebook Live. And then, Lord, we ask that God on Sunday, when we come with that greatest gift that we have to give. We come with our spirit for worship and praise like never before. God, we're gonna come prepared to worship and to praise you. In the mighty name of Jesus. And then, Lord, as we leave this place, remember thy presence. Be with us. In Jesus' name. Amen. I want to say on Sunday when we come,
amen.
On Sunday when we come, let us come with our white and denim, and let us come with the greatest offering back to God that we can give him. Hear me carefully. The offering is not because the church needs something. We don't need anything. But what we need to do is rededicate our givings back to God. Amen? So we want to come, and if you purpose in your heart today that you're going to give God your greatest gift that you ever given him. That means you're going to give something that you never gave before. And you purpose in your heart, God's going to give it to you between now and Sunday. So let's try God. Huh? Mm. To bring our greatest gift. Can we do that?
Amen.
When you agree, you say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It's challenging because if God going to give you the greatest gift, he's going to give you the greatest resources you ever seen. Amen. But you got to trust God that God's going to give it to you. And then when he gives it to you, you got to trust God enough to give it to him. He only wants a portion. He don't want the whole. Amen?
Amen.
Now, those who going to be working in the garden, which I'll be working between now and Good Friday. You want to come out to the house today, help me with my garden? You can come on out to the house. But I'm gonna be making my road. We are dismissed. God bless you.
Members, really, really.